Welcome in to the Sports Blitz on a Wednesday. I'm your host, Mark Freeman, with Mattie Lasiter here in the Cogswell Motors studio. Got a lot of stuff to talk about today. Hogs are on a bye week, so we want to discuss improvement.
We will definitely not lose this weekend.
There is a 100% chance the Razorbacks will not lose this weekend.
That's what we were saying last week. We have something to look forward to.
There is a 100%. I think the bye came at a perfect time. It couldn't have come at a better time, win or lose. And Brett Bielema made mention of this yesterday. You've got five games, then a bye. I think four games and then a bye. And then 3 weeks to finish the year. And then hopefully a bowl game to play after that. So the season's broken up, although you've got some ridiculous games. And we're going to look at the college football games of the year, or the games of the weekend, and some of the games of the year are this weekend. You've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 SEC teams, and I believe all of them are Western Division. All of them are Western Division teams all playing one another this weekend. So you've got three SEC West ranked team matchups. If Arkansas had beaten Texas A&M, all seven teams in the SEC West would have been ranked. For the first time ever, you'd have an entire division all ranked. That's the division that Arkansas is in right now. That's why people said before the year, Arkansas could be much better and it not show on the record. I think they're going to beat somebody they shouldn't beat based on the rankings. I've asked today's CrossFit Russellville poll question, and I appreciate David for giving me the idea. He asked if Arkansas, it's a simple question, has Arkansas improved every week this year? You look through the first five games, has there been marked improvement each week? You beat the crap out of a couple teams early on, Nichols and Texas Tech and Northern Illinois, and you've stepped your way up to, obviously Auburn, that first game was a tough loss. You played all right, and then you win the next game against, I guess it was Texas Tech or Nichols. Which one was it first? It was Texas Tech that was the second game, right? And then Nichols, and then, it was Nichols, then Texas around, Tech, yeah. Then Northern Illinois. Sorry, I'm thinking on the fly here. And then Texas A&M. I think Arkansas may have improved every week. The first half of the Auburn game was pretty good. The second half was bad, so you can improve on that the second week against Texas Tech. And then as you improve, you see that they didn't have to play a full four-quarter game to win that game. It was a three-touchdown win. They were better than Texas Tech. But you see improvement, obviously, from week one to week two. Then the Nichols game, you can probably argue that they didn't improve from game two to game three, but a 73-7 win, it's pretty hard not to say that they improved. I think that they showed some things, their ability to just dominate. And then it carried over the next week because they beat Northern Illinois like a drum. The next week, the defense scored a touchdown. The special teams scored a touchdown. I mean, they scored a touchdown in all three phases, so they improved that week. And I think you had to have improved from Northern Illinois to Texas A&M to play the way they did against the top 10 team in the country. And they should have won that game. I watched the replay last night, and it was just, I had to stop it, I'll be honest, because I knew how it was going to end. I knew what was happening, but I had to stop it. I saw so much improvement, man. And Maddie, the trip, my dad sent me a video of the trip. It wasn't the one you were talking about. What happened was he got beat. Dan Skipper got beat. He falls down. He kicks his leg up, and that's what you saw. What happened after that, though, is that the guy was still stuck behind him, and he turned around, Dan Skipper did, and kicked his left leg hard into this guy's shin to try to take him down. It was the most blatant trip in history. I don't know why. I mean, it's a penalty, I know. I don't know what in the world he was doing. Brett Bielema was taking all the blame for it, saying he's got to coach him better. You got a mean streak, and that's fine, but you've got to tell the guy, hey, Clay Henry made this point on the radio I heard yesterday, the day before, where he said he likes to play up to and just past the line, and you've got to sort of back him off a little bit. The only way I could see this being Brett Bielema's fault is if he said, go ahead and be dirty. I don't think he said that. So I think Dan Skipper's got to take that on himself, and I don't want to place too much blame on Dan Skipper, even though he did have two big plays, one being a touchdown called back because of his penalties, because it's guys like Dan Skipper who give you the opportunity to be in that game anyway. So I've asked that poll question today. Has Arkansas improved every week? How have you seen Arkansas improve? through the first 5 weeks of the year. Give us your thoughts. You can give us a call at 968-NEWS. It's 968-6397. You can find us on Facebook. To answer that question, if you can't call and you don't have time to answer it, you can go to facebook.com/sportsblitz and find that poll question there, and you can type your answer out. I'll read it here in just a little bit. But you can call if you'd like. And if you want to find me on Twitter, at RealMarkFreeman. Yeah. I don't have the little verification check yet, but
it's coming.
Of a big deal. Jokey joke. Appreciate you guys joining us today. We'll talk some more Arkansas Razorbacks here in a little bit. Did you see that the Royals won last night? Big baseball. Sorry, Weldon, your A's are going home in the wild card one-game playoff. An exciting win for the Kansas City Royals. I'll be honest with you. I was looking for the game at the end because it was like 7-3 Oakland, and Kansas City came all the way back to tie it, and then they had a runner on. I was looking at the phone, SportsCenter app, and they had a runner on base and maybe second or third base and two outs, and I was trying to find it, and I don't know if they went to commercial or what happened, but I didn't find the game, and then I went to sleep. So I'm too old to sit up and watch this stuff, especially with a five-month-old. So I was Tony Kornheiser in it, fell asleep a little early. Kansas City comes back to win, and it was an exciting game there for the Royals. And now they'll get to go to the ALDS, where they will take on Washington, I think, Washington Nationals. I may be crazy to say that. And I may, you know, I hate baseball, so maybe crazy with that. And then tonight, you've got the San Francisco Giants and the Pittsburgh Pirates in another one-game playoff situation there. I kind of like the two wild-card situation that Major League Baseball has instituted. It gives people, you know, the ALDS, NLDS, unless you're a big baseball fan, sometimes there's some bad matchups. Now you've got guys that are teams that get upset and teams that come out of nowhere to go make a World Series run, but for the most part, it's sort of ho-hum, business as usual. Here's the Cardinals. Here are lots of years of the Red Sox. We'll see you guys in the next round. They're just going to win. There's no question about it. This year, you got the Kansas City Royals. First time in the playoffs since the year I was born. Yeah, that was a great... 1985 was a great year for me and the Kansas City Royals and all their fans. They won the game last night. They won a playoff game. Now they get to go on to the next round, and the Pirates or the Giants won will be able to experience that same level of elation tonight. I guess the game's in Pittsburgh, which would make that an Eastern time game, 8 o'clock Eastern, 7 o'clock here.
Your math.
Me and math don't get along too well. Anyway, so I want to hit some wire-related topics because the high school games of the week we'll talk about in football here in just a little bit. Dover Pulaski Robinson is, to me, the class of this week. A lot of games on the road, so we technically don't call road games for these local teams our games of the week. So the local game that's going to be taking place here in the River Valley this week is Dover Pulaski Robinson, and that's going to be a good one. But we'll talk about those games here in a moment. Man, I'm seeing so much stuff going on the wire right now that it's sort of, I know it's football season, but there's a little bit more news right now than you would even have expected off the field, other than just games. Tom Brady and the New England Patriots, the offense is bad right now. I saw that Matthew Berry, the ESPN fantasy expert, doesn't even have Tom Brady in this week's top 200. Like, that's a statement. That's saying that the Patriots are terrible right now. They're playing awful. And you know, they don't have any answer offensively for teams that say, all right, we're going to come get Tom Brady, and we're going to make your receivers beat us. They don't have anybody that can beat them. Rob Gronkowski's not quite all there right now. He's not quite back. They don't have the murdering Aaron Hernandez to, you know, line up in the backfield and run some and split out and catch passes and really be a matchup nightmare and take pressure off Rob Gronkowski. Now you've got, and I heard Colin Cowherd making this mention the other day, it used to be Julian Edelman was like a fourth or fifth option. Now he's the option. He's number one. And I don't know what happened to Danny Amendola. I really liked him a couple years ago when he was in St. Louis. I had him on my fantasy team, picked him up off the waiver wire, and he was great until he got hurt. So the thought was his only issue would be staying healthy. Well, his issue has been jiving with Tom Brady at all. And New England is a mess right now. I wonder if the Jets might come in and win the NFC or the AFC East and take it from the New England Patriots, who, you know, you didn't see this coming before the year. You see Browner and Darrelle Revis come in on the defensive side. You know they've got Tom Brady and Gronk coming back on the offensive side, and you think New England's about to roll. Well, now they're middle of the pack at best in the AFC. So that's something to talk about. Brady Hoke. Speaking of Brady's, Brady Hoke at Michigan, will he last the year? I really have my doubts whether or not he's going to be the whole now concussion situation. He had a quarterback who, you know, obviously concussed. You saw him hit the ground. Unless Brady Hoke had turned around to coach someone up about something and he didn't see it, there's no excuse for him to. And even there is no excuse, because after the game he would have had to have seen the film or seen a highlight or been told about something. He sees his player get up, wobbly, can barely stand, has to lean against the lineman to stand up, and then he says he has a foot or ankle injury. He may not play. Really, like, that's the injury you're worried about? He's got his brain jarred and he can't see straight, right? He doesn't know where he is. Brady Hoke, it's trouble. Michigan is in bad shape. They had students are, for the most part right now, morons. I was one recently, and I know I'm sort of a moron, but they just look for reasons to go grab signs and walk around and picket. A lot of these people, one of them was wearing Ohio State gear. They're out picketing saying, fire the athletic director, Brandon. Let's get rid of him because we don't really know why. They're raising ticket prices. They're commercializing the University of Michigan. They're trying to sell things, which is college sports in general right now. I don't know why the only reason they're mad is because Michigan football sucks right now. They had a wide receiver playing quarterback. Now they've got a concussed guy playing quarterback, and your coach is in over his head. You got beat down by Minnesota, and now everybody's mad. And so you got to fire the athletic director. I know that sort of comes with the job, but it's kind of a messed up situation where people are going after a coach because the team's not that good this year. 1 year. They weren't great last year, but this has sort of been one of those Murphy's Law years where everything that can go wrong has for the Michigan Wolverines. We'll see if Brady Hoke will last the year. If he can last the next 2 weeks, I think he'll be all right, but I'm not sure with the heat if it turns up anymore, I'm not sure he won't just resign. I doubt he'd resign in the middle of the year. We'll see. Michael Phelps saw that he got arrested for his second DWI or DUI in the last 10 years. He got another one in 2004. He says he's deeply sorry. He's going to lose a lot of money in sponsorships, a whole lot. Subway is not going to be having him in any more commercials anytime soon. I'll just go ahead and say that. Michael Phelps, looks like he's going to try to make – I wonder if this will affect his Olympic return. He's trying to go to, I think, his fourth Olympics, and the question about whether or not he retired, no, he came back, the question about whether or not he can do it may be overshadowed by the fact that nobody may want him to do it. They may not want to pay him money to be out there and represent them, and that may ruin him. I don't know. We'll see. He can probably overcome it, but still a bad deal. Also, let's see. I think there was something else, but I can't really remember what it was. So, all right, let's look real quickly at high school football. Last week's game of the week, Dardanelle 41, Pottsville 14. The skill position talent we mentioned at Dardanelle is overwhelming folks in the 4A4, and I'm looking forward to seeing if they can continue that through the season. They've had a couple of years similar to this where they started out hot and then sort of floundered down the stretch. A lot of that, it has to do with injuries most of the time, but I'll be interested to see if Dardanelle can stay healthy at key positions. You know, because in high school, you really don't have a whole lot of depth most of the time at your skill and key positions. And if you have to replace a quarterback, that can change everything on a dime. If you have to replace a great linebacker or your cover corner or whatever it might be, then things can change. But I'd like to see if Dardanelle can continue this and make a deep run in the 4A this year. I think they're the best team overall in the River Valley. I know Russellville's here, and they're a 6A school. Hector's really good in 2A. Dover's undefeated in 4A. Lamar is really good in 3A. Lamar might be, and this is crazy, this is going to sound crazy, Hector and Lamar may be Dardanelle's biggest test as far as the best team in the River Valley. A 2A school and a 3A school. Maybe Dardanelle, and then a 4A school being the best. That's saying something. Clarksville's 5A, Russellville is 6A, and we're talking about Dardanelle, Lamar, and Hector. That's saying something. That's great coaching. Mark Taylor at Hector, Josh Jones at Lamar, and Josh Price at Dardanelle. Hey, isn't that surprising that last year's Brightest Stars Banquet Coach of the Year candidates, Josh Price, Josh Jones, Mark Taylor. How cool is that? That those three guys who have risen to the top as far as, you know, being the cream of the crop coaches in this area are now this year. Now, this is based on last year. They're now this year rising to the top. That just shows you how good they are. And it shows you that everybody in the area, because these were coaches that voted on best coach and coach of the year and those types of things. These are coaches that voted. It shows that the coaches from this area know how good Josh Price, Josh Jones, and Mark Taylor are. And that's an ultimate respect for them. I'm looking forward to the Brightest Stars Banquet this year. It's going to be a really good event. I'm going to have invitations mailed out and some sort of preliminary stuff coming out by the beginning of 2015 so that we can get things rolling for a May banquet this year. This last year, I had a two-week-old son at the house. Oh, man, think about May for me. Think about April for me. That was a crazy, crazy month getting ready for that banquet. And this year, we're going to do an even better job. But that's neither here nor there. This week's game of the week is going to be, without question, Dover hosting Pulaski Robinson. You're going to find out this week if Dover's for real. If Dover's the real deal, they'll be able to at least compete with a Pulaski Robinson team that, if I'm not mistaken, is undefeated. There's a former Russellville Cyclone as an assistant coach there, Tim McKelvey, a friend who is now assistant coach at Pulaski Robinson, and I see his quotes and comments about the game. I think they're undefeated. If not, they're still a very good team, and Dover will find out a whole lot about themselves after what has amounted to a decent schedule to start, but not anything near the level of competition they're about to get to. They beat Atkins, they beat Cedarville, Mayflower, and Subiaco Academy, and Pulaski Robinson is another step up. So we'll see if Dover can compete and can win and can stake that claim as one of the best teams in this area. Other games this week: Atkins is traveling to Marianna, Clarksville is at Maumelle, Danville hosts Boonville, Dardanelle hosts Clinton, Hector is at Magazine, Lamar hosts Mansfield, Pottsville hosts Arkansas Baptist, Russellville's at Greenwood, Two Rivers is at hosting Lavaca, and Western Yale County hosts Hackett. So if you can't make it to your team's game, I would encourage you to make it over to Dover and watch the Pirates and the Pulaski Robinson. What are they, the Senators, I think, Pulaski Robinson? I may have just completely made that up. We'll look up Pulaski Robinson's mascot, and we'll be back right after the break.
Hi folks, Richard Roberts with Cogswell Motors in Russellville. You know, we've been in business since 1949. A dealership doesn't stay in business that long under the same ownership unless you're doing something right, and that's taking care of customers. We have the largest selection of new Ford, Lincoln, Mazda, and pre-owned vehicles in the River Valley. So if you want the most for your trade, the best interest rate on financing, and the best price on a new or pre-owned automobile, come to Russellville and see us. We're at 1900 East Main, or visit us on the web at CogswellMotors.com.
If you didn't count on KARK 4 today, this morning,
here's what you missed.
Updated news.
Police continue searching for suspects after a home intrusion overnight.
Developing stories.
It's another piece of presidential history turning up here in Arkansas.
And weather and traffic on the 4s.
Friday night, Saturday morning will bring us our next chance of rain.
Every 10 minutes.
Around the clock.
Making your day easier.
So rise and shine and count on.
Count on.
Count on. KARK 4 today.
Today, there are more than 20 brands of cars being sold in America. So to be noticed, Ford and Cogswell Motors have to go further than anyone thought we could. How does Ford stand out above the crowd? not just with plug-in vehicles like the new 2013 Ford Fusion Energy that gets a projected 100 miles per gallon equivalent, but also with a line of gas vehicles equipped with the innovative EcoBoost engines combining power and efficiency, plus a full measure of technologically advanced features. We invite you to stop into Cogswell Motors today. We go further than anyone thought we could, so that you can go further too.
RiverValleyLeader.com is the number one local source for instant news in the River Valley, offering HD video and live streaming along with top-notch coverage of all the news and events around the area. The River Valley Leader is the only place to go for all the information you need. Check out the newest local business featured on the site, as well as police news and coverage from important meetings along with the personal stories, all at one convenient click. Check out RiverValleyLeader.com.
Welcome back to a Wednesday on the Sports Blitz. Mark Freeman, Mattie Lasiter here in the Cogswell Motors studios. We've asked a very simple CrossFit Russellville poll question today. How, if you believe Arkansas has improved, and I believe Arkansas has improved every week of this schedule, how do you think they've improved? If you don't, then you just say no. I try not to make yes or no answers to poll questions, because then you'll just see yes, yes, no, yes, no. But we've asked today, if you think Arkansas's improved this year, every game of the season, how have you seen them improve? Because I think that's an interesting conversation. Speaking of Arkansas and interesting, Brett Bielema made mention of Randy Ramsey. We heard that he was going to be playing this last week against Texas A&M. He's one of those guys that everybody was counting on to provide depth at the linebacker position. And apparently he had some academic issues last week, and Brett Bielema just left him at home. They just said, all right, you're going to have to take care of your business, and we're going to leave you at home. That just, to me, it tells me how serious that this coaching staff takes things like academics and things like taking care of your business off the field. You've seen that there have been no arrests, not even a whiff of legal or off the field issues for the Razorbacks this year, which has been a breath of fresh air. I think we don't commend this team enough for. I know that doing the right thing is you're supposed. Yeah, it's the old Chris Rock joke. People say I haven't been to jail. What do you want to cook? You ain't supposed to go to jail. I know they're not supposed to get in trouble, but college kids, you would think that at least one of them would have a public intox by now, or would have been pulled over and DWI or something like that. Nothing. No fails, no fail out of a summer class or out of any class at all. You've seen the GPA been raised every semester under Brett Bielema. I think we need to commend the University of Arkansas for the men that they're choosing, the young men that they're choosing, how they're disciplining them. I mean, think about I don't know what he did. Maybe he failed a test or had a bad sort of progress report, so to speak, midway through a semester. I'm sure that the academic staff is keeping track of everything with these students, every grade, and they probably got some sort of bad report. And this is all speculation on my part. And he says, all right, you haven't taken care of your business. We're not going to take you to Jerry World. Think about how painful that would have been for Randy Ramsey. You think he's going to get the point? You think he's going to get his junk together? Brett Bielema says that apparently the issue has been taken care of. He'll be back in the mix for Alabama, and that's good news. And I know this is just a little bit of an aside, Mattie, but I wanted to throw in there that it's a cool thing for Arkansas to have players that can play on the field but also aren't, the jailblazers, so to speak. You remember the old trailblazers that were always in trouble, or those Miami teams where you have four or five felons on the team. You don't have any of that stuff going on right now. I'm extremely happy with what I've seen from the Arkansas football team this year, the program in general, taking care of its business and not having to worry about off-the-field issues. I'm just, I don't know. I'm happy about the way things have progressed under Brett Bielema. So I think that's one way they've improved. They're not having to deal with off-the-field troubles. They're not having to deal with troubled players and things like that. I think that things are going to go only up from here. So
yeah, so far this year, we're not like Florida, and that's one of the things that stuck out to me even when they had the, I guess it was the 11-2 team, Sugar Bowl team, right?
Yeah.
Louisville loss. That team was so undisciplined. And you could tell it wasn't just a bad coaching thing. They were just kind of wild and just, they seemed like a bunch of punks. And it's really refreshing. Not that Arkansas was ever like that, but it's really refreshing to see that discipline. And the way, you know, that Brett Bielema pretty much told Alex Collins, don't jump into the crowd ever again or I'm going to do something to you.
Yeah.
And now he just hands the ball to the ref. Yeah. And it's so respectful and it's, you know, the guys still celebrate, but it's all in bounds type thing, yeah. You know. And I
the worst
really
thing we can
like
talk
that.
About is whether or not Dan Skipper's dirty. You know, no off-the-field issues, nothing like that. That's a pretty good deal. So I wonder today if there has been another team. Now, there are a lot of coaching changes coming into last year where, you know, last year was the first year for a couple of coaches. Has any other school improved as much over the last 2 years as Arkansas? And I don't want to go as far as saying, you know, 2 years ago, Auburn won zero SEC games. Last year, they went to the national championship game, were 15 seconds from being national champion. So I don't want to say that Arkansas has improved as much as Auburn because they haven't. They haven't. But in this 2 year span, you know, Brett Bielema was 3-9 last year. This year, the team looks better. Has there been another school in this same time period that has improved as much as Arkansas has? I think that's an interesting question. I don't know if there's anybody who has improved over that same time period as much as Arkansas.
I think it depends on how you say that when you're talking about Auburn, because obviously you can't argue with what Auburn did. And of course, their record was terrible. But just looking at team to team, Arkansas was awful. Like, Auburn had some players, and they were bad, obviously, if you only win as many games as they did. But it's hard to say yet because we're not even halfway through the season. But I don't think it's a stretch to say that it's comparable, even though we know what Auburn did because I think the levels are different. I think Auburn was here and Arkansas was that much lower. They were that much worse.
I will give you that I think Arkansas has probably improved more. They haven't accomplished more, but they've improved more because Auburn had great recruiting classes all along.
Yeah, that's exactly what I
mean. And a lot of these
guys
were recruited to play in the Gus Malzahn style, and when he comes back and, you know, he can play these players that he recruited to play his system, it was sort of a match made in heaven, so to speak, and he had guys that he could, and I know he had to find a quarterback, but I don't think Brett Bielema had nothing. Like, the cupboard was completely bare when he got to Arkansas, and he had Jonathan Williams who was coming in. I mean, really, who else did Brett Bielema have? And he got Brandon Allen, okay, that's fine. He got Alex Collins as a recruit himself. He got, you know, his staff got some of the recruits, all the offensive line recruits. He had Travis Swanson, I guess. That was about it. I mean, he really had nothing to work with.
And there are so many young guys that you see that are contributing in big, big ways, and that's, you know, testament to his recruiting.
Yeah.
He knows what he needed right now. So
I want to look at, and we've got a week and a half to do this, but I want to look at how Arkansas recovers against Alabama and really what, because I don't think anybody in their right mind expects Arkansas to beat Alabama. I know it's in Fayetteville. I know that the team has improved every week, but I don't think anybody expects them to beat Alabama. How do you go about bouncing back from this tough loss and what we presume to be another loss and continue to move forward rather than fall back? You would have lost, if you lose to Alabama, you will have lost to three top five teams. I mean, top six teams. I think the A&M was ranked number six.
Yeah, they were.
So three top six teams if you were to lose to Alabama. I don't think that's anything to really be too upset about.
And I expect Alabama to beat, not that this matters, but I expect Alabama to beat Ole Miss.
Yeah.
So an Ole Miss,
and
is
we're going to talk about the games
Alabama
the week after this.
Is third, so that would be losing to number six Auburn, losing to number six A&M. If we lose to Alabama, three or two or one likely.
Yeah.
So
I just wonder how Arkansas can bounce back from this loss. You saw it with Pottsville. You know, they played two big games right in a row in high school. They played Russellville, had them down. I mean, it's basically the same thing. They had them down two touchdowns and crapped it away. I don't know how else to say it. They fumbled it four times through a pick. They lost that game, and then the next week they come back, and you hope Arkansas doesn't have that same sort of situation where Dardanelle just put it on them. Now, a lot of people expected Dardanelle to win that game anyway, so it was the better team winning, just kind of like Alabama versus Arkansas. You hope Arkansas can be a little bit more mentally tough and can bounce back. You just don't want a 52-0 game like last year and the year before. You want, at the very worst, maybe a two. If you can keep it within two touchdowns, then I know that's terrible, and we don't like moral victories, but that would be something where up in here it says, okay, we got beat 52-0 the last couple of years, and this year, even though we lost and it's our third loss in six games, we kept it closer. We're improving. We can see the improvement.
Yeah, I think this is a critical game for that very reason. I think that you can't have a loss like that, like we've had the past 2 years against Alabama, because it would be such a blow to the confidence of these guys moving forward. You can't have that kind of mental letdown, because that's what it was, more than physical. And not that, you know, Alabama out-physicaled Arkansas both of those years when they just beat us like a drum, and South Carolina too. But you don't lose 52-0 without just having some issues on the mental side of football. So I think it will be – I don't expect Arkansas to win, but I'm going to be curious to see exactly like what you're saying, how they bounce back from this past loss. And how they bounce back from this loss if they do happen to win, which I expect they will. You know,
ugh, if you know how mad, obviously 99.99, all the rational people in the world expect Arkansas to lose to Alabama. Imagine how mad everyone would be if Arkansas beat Alabama. Like, you had Texas A&M on the ropes. You played Auburn to a tie in the first half and came out and sucked. If you beat Alabama, that's the what if, what could have been, could have, should have, would have. Oh man! And then every game from then on, if you lose, you know, it's a terrible thing. If you win, it's just gonna be a roller coaster. I just hope Arkansas can play well enough in that Alabama game to make it a four quarter game, man. Just make it a four quarter game. Even if I don't want Arkansas to be ahead at the in the fourth quarter and then lose the game. I just want them to keep it close enough. And I hate moral victories, but at this point, I'll take any kind of thing that says victory at the end for Arkansas. So. We'll look real quickly after the break at the games of the week. There are, right here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 games between both ranked teams this week. Some of the best college football in years that's taking place this weekend. And Arkansas doesn't play, so there's no chance Arkansas is going to lose. And you get to watch 6 SEC West ranked teams play one another. You get to watch three other games that are going to take place this weekend between ranked teams that I want to look at real closely after the break. I think there are some really, really good games.
Hi folks, Richard Roberts with Cogswell Motors in Russellville. You know, we've been in business since 1949. A dealership doesn't stay in business that long under the same ownership unless you're doing something right, and that's taking care of customers. We have the largest selection of new Ford, Lincoln, Mazda, and pre-owned vehicles in the River Valley. So if you want the most for your trade, the best interest rate on financing, and the best price on a new or pre-owned automobile, come to Russellville and see us. We're at 1900 East Main, or visit us on the web at CogswellMotors.com.
If you didn't count on KARK for today, this morning,
here's what you missed.
Updated news.
Police continue searching for suspects after a home intrusion overnight.
Developing stories.
It's another piece of presidential history turning up here in Arkansas.
And weather and traffic on the force.
Friday night, Saturday morning will bring us our next chance rain.
Every 10 minutes.
Around the clock.
Making your day easier.
So rise and shine and count on.
Count on.
Count on. KARK for today.
Today, there are more than 20 brands of cars being sold in America. So to be noticed, Ford and Cogswell Motors have to go further than anyone thought we could. How does Ford stand out above the crowd? Not just with plug-in vehicles like the new 2013 Ford Fusion Energy that gets a projected 100 miles per gallon equivalent, but also with a line of gas vehicles equipped with the innovative EcoBoost engines combining power and efficiency, plus a full measure of technologically advanced features. We invite you to stop into Cogswell Motors today. We go further than anyone thought we could, so that you can go further too.
RiverValleyLeader.com is the number one local source for instant news in the River Valley. Offering HD video and live streaming along with top-notch coverage of all the news and events around the area. The River Valley Leader is the only place to go for all the information you need. Check out the newest local business featured on the site as well as police news and coverage from important meetings, along with the personal stories, all at one convenient click. Check out rivervalleyleader.com.
I need somebody to call Green Day. Tell them to wake up. And 2005, 6, I think it's 5, maybe even 4, we'll be very happy. Yeah, that's how old I am. I'm talking about songs from 2004. Wake them up, because September has ended. Welcome back to the Sports Blitz on a Wednesday. Sometimes I get the day wrong. I say on a Friday and it's a Wednesday, or a Wednesday and it's a Friday, and today I got it right. Today's Wednesday. Mark Freeman, Mattie Lasiter in the Cogswell Motors studio. Lots of college football on the agenda today. And because the reason we do this, not only because we love talking about the Razorbacks, love getting your opinion on the Razorbacks, but this is one of the best weekends college football in recent memory. I don't like to go hyperbolic and say this is the best weekend ever, but I can't remember a weekend with this many good games in a long time. Now, there have been, you know, bowl weekends and things like that where you've got good games to watch, but this weekend you've got 6 really, really good games. I don't know. I guess the game of the week to me would probably be Alabama at Ole Miss. But you've got A&M at Mississippi State. You've got Oklahoma at TCU, Stanford at Notre Dame, LSU at Auburn, and Nebraska at Michigan State. We'll start with the non-SEC games that fewer people care about. Nebraska, number 19, at number 10, Michigan State. I expect Michigan State's going to win that game. I think Nebraska's a little overrated, although they did nearly lost to McNeese State. Arkansas Tech went down to McNeese State, number 4 in the FCS right now, and they found out how good McNeese State actually is this last week. So, but if you're Nebraska, you're a top 25 FBS ranked team, you can't nearly lose. Should have lost. I mean, if it weren't for Amir Abdullah and the miracle play that he pulled off to win that game, Nebraska loses. I think he took like a screen pass or something, 60 yards with 25 seconds left to win that game. And it was just crazy the way they won that game. But I think Michigan State, the pound, it'll be too much for Nebraska. I think Michigan State will win that game, and they'll sort of bounce back into the conversation. I know they lost to Oregon, and the Big Ten has been so bad this year that they have eliminated themselves from all discussion about being in the playoffs. I told you before the season that I expected Michigan State to be in the playoff because, for one, with Braxton Miller healthy, Ohio State brings another viable Big Ten team into the discussion. We thought Michigan was going to be a little better. You knew Michigan State was going to be pretty good, and you expected some of these teams to play a little bit better. But I thought with those two, Ohio State and Michigan State, that Michigan State would win that game like they did in the Big Ten championship game once again, and it would vault them over a team like Oklahoma, who I figured we'd go undefeated, and I just didn't figure they'd play anybody in the entire season, and they're not going to. They're not going to play anybody. By the time the season's over, they're going to be 12-0, but they will have played 0 teams worth mentioning. No conference championship game. Texas sucks right now. Everybody else in that conference is just not good.
Texas Tech sucks.
Texas Tech is awful. Like,
Baylor's decent. I guess that would be a game. Baylor? I don't know.
Well, if they play Baylor, that sort of shuts me up because
I'm just trying to think of any decent teams over there.
I don't even think that they had Baylor on their schedule, but that Baylor would be in the Big 12 North, I think. Let me look at Oklahoma's schedule. But initially I thought Oklahoma would be out on the outside looking in, even though they were undefeated, and I expected Michigan State to have a loss. I expected Oregon to beat them. I said that preseason. I said Oregon and Michigan State would both still be in the college football playoff. Oklahoma does play Baylor, number 7 Baylor, on November the 8th. So they've got one game against the top 10 team. They're playing number 25 TCU this week. Woohoo! They're great. They're wonderful. And then they're playing number 23 Kansas State. We saw them nearly beat Auburn, but outside of that, I watched them play Iowa State, and they don't look very good. I expect Oklahoma to win that game. And then they play number 21 Oklahoma State, and we watched them play Texas Tech, and neither one of those teams looked any good at all. So, but it is bedlam. It is a big game for Oklahoma. So it's nowhere near an SEC schedule. I don't want to make that. I just want to make that clear. It's not an SEC West schedule when you play 6 teams that could possibly be ranked in the top 25, and a lot of them even, you know, upper tier type teams. it's not even a conversation whether or not you deserve to be in the playoff.
If they played Arkansas' schedule, they would likely be 3-2 as well. They would have lost to Auburn.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, they would have lost both to A&M. Arkansas did.
So let's just take a look at that. Where Arkansas is near the bottom at the West, and if Oklahoma played that schedule, that's where they would be.
I think you're right. I think if Oklahoma played in the SEC West, they would be in the exact same spot. If they just flipped spots, I don't know that Arkansas would win the Big 12. They would probably come up against Baylor, and that'd be a bad matchup. It'd be a bad matchup for Baylor, too, though. Arkansas could win the Big 12 this year. They really might.
Well, you know,
there's a really good possibility they're going to get last in the SEC West.
Well, they've talked a lot about how good Arkansas is this year as compared to where we were last year, and I've read a few articles where sports writers have said if Arkansas was in the East, they would be favored in every single one of those games, I think, except for one of their East schedule.
Yeah, I read that.
So, I mean, when you look at that.
It's a murderer's row.
Yeah, it's rough.
It's awful.
Arkansas is good. We're just
a year or two too early.
That's exactly right. Yeah.
Anyway, Nebraska, Michigan State. Back to that game. I've got Michigan State winning that one close. And then I mentioned Oklahoma at TCU. It's a road game for Oklahoma. I don't think TCU's any good. I think they win that game by 2+ touchdowns. And they sort of Oklahoma at this point. The committee's not supposed to worry about margin of victory, but they've got to get some style points because they don't really play any teams. They've got to punish the teams that they do play, the quality opponents. So I think that's probably what Oklahoma's going to try to do. They're probably going to try. But sometimes when Oklahoma try, and I'm from Oklahoma, so I've got family in Oklahoma, know a lot about the team and the area and the way people think. Sometimes when Oklahoma tries to get style points, they struggle to win the game. Sometimes they even lose the game. And when they come out and they aren't expected to play all that well, I remember a couple years back, it's been more than a decade now, they played Texas A&M at Texas A&M, and it was supposed to be this huge battle. And Oklahoma, how's Oklahoma going to win this game with the 12th? It was 77-0 mid-third quarter. Oklahoma just drilled them. But this type of game against TCU where you expect them to go get some style points, that'll turn into a close game. So I could see Oklahoma blowing them out, and if things go according to their plan, they're going to try to get some style points. But beware of Oklahoma showing up and not playing all that well in this type of game. I respect Gary Patterson as a defensive mind, and I wonder if he can keep Oklahoma close in that one. And then another one between two top 15 teams, number 14 Stanford, number 9 Notre Dame. That's a big game it's not a Pac-12 game, but it's a rivalry game. Stanford flying across the country to Notre Dame to play there in Indiana. That's going to be – I really don't know who I think will win that game. Stanford has not been all that impressive. Notre Dame, I didn't think was going to be as good as they are. So, man, just if I had to pick the game right now, knowing Notre Dame's at home, if you don't give me any points and I'm just picking the winner, I'd have a hard time going against Stanford, but – it is at Notre Dame, so that would be a very close matchup in my mind as far as who I would pick to win. I would probably favor Stanford, but just very slightly. If Notre Dame wins, it's the home field advantage that did it for them. Just Golden Domers may pull it off.
About either of those teams.
I don't either. I don't care about that game at all. Now to the SEC games that are intriguing to me. Number 15 LSU, number 5 Auburn. LSU going to start a new quarterback.
No, wait a minute.
At Auburn.
LSU's still ranked 15th?
Yeah.
How?
I didn't rank them.
I'm just saying. I mean, they got drilled at home.
Mississippi State haven't looked good
the whole year.
That's the thing, though. They came back, and Mississippi State is now ranked number 12 in the country. So it was
that seems completely I think it was like off
a,
to me.
What was it? It was like 13 versus 14 matchup, and LSU moves from 13 to 15. Yeah, you lost at home but to an SEC-ranked team.
Looking at their whole resume so far, they should have lost to Wisconsin, and it should have, could have, would, I know.
That's why they're still ranked. They beat Wisconsin. They beat all the other teams they put in front of them. No, I don't feel that good.
Back up and look at it this way. Are they the 15th best team in the country? No way. No way.
Well, I mean, I think they are. I don't think it's just the SEC West for you, man. They beat Wisconsin. in a neutral site. They beat Wisconsin, didn't play all that well and still beat them, beat the other teams that they had in front of them, and then they played an SEC West team and they lost. I mean, the committee will take this into consideration
later. It's good for all of us if all these teams stay ranked. But,
well, and I think that the people are finally starting to understand how good the SEC is, especially the West, and they're not punishing teams by knocking them all the way out of the top 25 because you lose an SEC West game, because people understand, oh, Mississippi State is legit. They played – and LSU, if they hadn't come back and made a game of it, maybe they fall way out of the – way down the rankings. But the fact that they came all the way back and I think they lost by 6 or 7, that's why it's not such a big deal. But they're at Auburn this week on the Plains. They're starting a freshman, true freshman quarterback. Last week, Jennings didn't look good. I think it's Brandon Harris is the starter now, the freshman. They also lost a defensive back, a nickelback, for the year, LSU did, torn ACL. So that's a rough time for them right now. Starting a new quarterback in Auburn, in Jordan Hare. I think Auburn's going to win the game. I think they're a better team. LSU could punish Auburn with the run and make this a closer game than people would expect, but I'm not really trusting too much in LSU's defense this year. Their players are always going to be really good. They're always going to be really well coached, but I don't know. Something's not clicking so far with LSU.
It has the potential to be a bad year for LSU.
And a bad loss, a bad year for them is 3 to 4 losses. Well, that's telling you where they are as a program when Arkansas is bouncing off a 9-loss year. So, yeah, I'm with you. I think LSU goes down in this game, but I could see them, Leonard Fournette, you pound it with him a bunch. I just don't see how a freshman quarterback is going to be. Auburn is going to say, you're not going to run it on us. Go ahead and try to beat us with the pass. You are not going to run it on us. We saw in the second half against Arkansas where Arkansas can pound against anyone running the football. In the second half, nothing against Auburn. I know some things went against them. They got down 7, then threw a pick, and it was 14, and they couldn't run anymore. They're trying to come back, but in the second half of that game, Auburn's run fits were much better. They were playing very, very well against the run, and Arkansas was in a bad way. I think they'll probably put LSU in that same situation. I expect Auburn to win that game. Texas A&M, number 6 in the country, playing Mississippi State on the road. They're going down this week. Mississippi State's going to beat Texas A&M. I think Texas A&M's overrated. I think they're good, but I don't think South Carolina's any good. Now, we saw last week they got beat again. They should have lost to – I say they should have lost. They beat East Carolina by 10 points. East Carolina put 70 on North Carolina, I know. I don't think South Carolina's any good, so going into their place and beating the crap out of them like Texas A&M did takes a little bit of a step down after what I've seen from South Carolina. And then last week what I saw on the field between Arkansas with very little depth and – just so much stuff going against them, 2 touchdowns called back, all the stuff that went Texas A&M's way to win that game, a defensive back falling down, a missed field goal. I mean, just a lot of – and I'm not saying that everything went Arkansas's way in that game or it went Texas A&M's way in that game. They had a guy fall down on a long touchdown, would have been a long touchdown. They missed the field goal. They threw an interception. I know it didn't all go their way, but from what I saw, the eye test that I saw, Texas A&M's just solid. They're not great. They don't have a running game at all. Like, what they did in the running game was minimal, and it was just not that effective. They threw the ball and put up so many yards because they were down 2 touchdowns and had to come back, and in my opinion, they got lucky. I think Mississippi State and the defensive line that they're going to put after Kenny Hill this weekend, I saw Kenny Hill in the first half. I was staring at him with my own eyes and watching his happy feet just bounce. He looked like Eli Manning back there, just uncomfortable as all get out and didn't know what to do when Trey Flowers was getting after him. Mississippi State's going to put even more pressure on him than Arkansas did, and they're going to beat Kenny Hill and Texas A&M this weekend. But I think that's a number 6, number 12 matchup. That's going to be a great, great game. Mississippi State, Mattie, we'll find out this weekend if they're for real.
And I think they are.
I do too.
Because I was watching some highlights. I didn't get to watch the game against LSU, but I got to watch some highlights of that game. And a couple others of theirs. And Dak Prescott.
Dude is bad.
He looks for real. Like, scary for real.
Dude is bad.
So, I mean, if they're solid on both sides of the ball on the lines, and Dak, it can be that kind of X factor for them offensively, then, man, it's going to be tough for anybody to get out of the West. But, I mean,
Mississippi State's solid.
They look pretty good.
Yeah. Well, when you're solid on the lines, you know, things sort of grow from there. And that's why I think Arkansas is doing really well right now. The offensive line, and I'm not really well on the field. I'm saying building the program. They're doing well. They're building the offensive and defensive lines. I wish they could get a couple more defensive line recruits, solid, like, top end.
We've had 8 sacks this year, which is, I think, tied for second lowest in the SEC.
But you got to think about the fact you're playing Texas Tech, throws it all over the place and throws quick. Texas A&M throws quick.
But then also
Auburn doesn't throw. You know,
6 of those 8 sacks were against Nichols, so we've had 2 in these other games. We've got to be.
No, you're right.
That.
They've got to get better.
And you're right. I mean, it's hard. You know, especially with a guy like Kenny Hill who wants to get rid of the ball a second after he gets it, type thing. It's hard to get a sack, but we've got to improve there.
Yep. No,
and I think
right.
that we will.
Looking at Alabama, this Alabama-Ole Miss game is the game of the week to me. It's number 3 Alabama at number 11 Ole Miss. Alabama, 9th in the country right now, points against. They're giving up 14 a game. They've played West Virginia, Florida Atlantic, Southern Miss, and Florida. Really, I don't think they've played a great team yet. I think that this Ole Miss team will be the best team they've played without question. Alabama will be the best team that Ole Miss has played. So, like we said about Mississippi State, we're going to find out if Ole Miss is for real. In games like this in recent years, if Alabama came rolling into Vaught-Hemingway and Ole Miss wasn't ready, it'd be a 3-touchdown Alabama slaughtering, and everybody would just stop talking about Ole Miss in general for the rest of the year, and they'd end up in the top 25 fringe. This year, Ole Miss is trying their best to say they're 3rd in the country in points against. They've only given up 8.5 points a game. Now, they've played Boise, Vanderbilt, Louisiana Lafayette, and Memphis. You think about the culture shock that's going to happen when Alabama rolls off the bus. Like, they're going to be playing against grown men when they've been playing against Memphis and Lafayette and Boise. I think Alabama's going to win this game. The fact that Alabama threw for 400 yards against Florida just blows my mind, because you know what they've got in Yeldon and Henry and Drake, and even LT Tenpenny was a 5-star and he's sitting on the bench. Arkansas, former North Little Rock running back, sitting on the bench, can't even get on the field, and he's a 5-star. It blows my mind how deep Alabama is there at running back, and they throw for 400 yards. I think Amari Cooper might just be the second best player in all of college football. Who's number one? Not Kenny Hill. If you say it, I'll throw something.
No.
Think SEC East.
Todd Gurley.
Absolutely. He's the best player in college football. And I think that Amari Cooper might be number two. That's high praise. For an Alabama wide receiver, you haven't said anything like that since Julio Jones. And aside from that, you hadn't said anything like that in a long time. I mean, you had some guys back in the day that at Alabama that were pretty good, but never really that good. So anyway, I think Alabama's going to win that game, but Ole Miss can prove a whole lot this year. And Alabama, I mean, they've showed some chinks in their armor this year. They haven't been all that great defensively. West Virginia put up 23 points on them, and then Florida put up 21, and Florida's defense was awful, and really, offense was awful. Really, to be fair, in that Florida-Alabama game, it could have been much, much worse on Alabama or on Florida if Alabama hadn't turned the ball over so much. They were fumbling and throwing picks, and just they didn't look very crisp at all. They're going to have to improve that.
And that's one of their big weaknesses. If you're going to say one chink in Alabama's armor, they've been bad this entire year, turnover margin. So that's something that we, looking forward to our game, that we can pinpoint as something that we need to keep that trend going. Also, before I let you go into your next point, I like the way that it sets up, because I expect Alabama to win this game against Ole Miss, but I also expect it to be a physical test, because we know the athletes that Hugh Freeze has recruited there, especially defensively. So I think that even if Alabama wins, as I expect them to, I think that that's going to be one of those games where we have a chance to get Alabama coming off of a huge road game type thing, you know, and I don't know if it's going to matter, but I do like the way that sets up for us playing Alabama, because we need all the help we can get there.
Bo Wallace, in 4 games, has 6 picks. How many picks does he throw against Alabama?
Man.
I'll say
now,
2.
Didn't he throw 3 in the first half against somebody? Who was that?
Against Boise in the first game.
Yeah, that's pretty rough.
Yeah, 3 in the first half. So, I mean, yeah, he's only thrown 3 since then in 3.5 games, but I think Alabama's going to put some guys out there on defense. Well,
would you say that Boise was the best team out of those four that they've played? Because Vanderbilt. Probably.
Memphis is decent.
Was bad.
Memphis may give Boise a run for its money.
If you're going to say, well, he's only thrown three interceptions since, well, maybe he threw the three in the first half against the best team that they played. Yeah, maybe. And he's going to be playing a team that's three times Boise, you know?
Looking at Alabama, this is the scary part about Alabama this year, and I don't think they're as good as in years past. I think they'll slowly come together and be a better team. I think they might be more well-rounded offensively than they've ever been under Nick Saban. This year, they're 12th in the country right now in passing yards, 335 passing yards a game. They're averaging 258 rushing yards a game, 19th in the country. And they're scoring 42 points a game, giving up only 14. I know that Alabama hasn't played many teams, but we're talking about how bad they've played, and their average score is 42-14. They're passing for 335 yards a game, and they're rushing for 258 yards a game. I think this one could get ugly for Ole Miss, but on the flip side, like I said, Alabama hasn't played Laquon Treadwell, haven't seen a Robert Kimdichie come running at your quarterback yet either. So there are some things to be considered. I think Bo Wallace is a huge wild card in this game. Can he contain himself and not throw stupid interceptions and just go complete Bo Wallace? Because I think Hugh Freeze might have something for Nick Saban if that's the case. But if Alabama can sort of boa constrictor you,
yeah, and just choke if Bo Wallace plays well, then let's all buckle up for a heck of a game.
Yeah,
but we don't expect Bo Wallace to play well consistently. I'll say that he plays well at times, every game, but then he'll throw three interceptions in a 8-minute span. So you can't do that.
I think Alabama's two touchdowns better. You give the roughly touchdown advantage for home field. I think it's a 10-point game Alabama's way. In that game, I think they're going to beat Ole Miss, and I think Ole Miss, they're just trying to hope to keep it close. I mean, no, they want to win, but their fans that are honest are probably just saying, all right, maybe this isn't the year for us to beat Alabama. Maybe we'll just keep it close, keep it within 7-10, and keep our heads down a little bit and wait till the Egg Bowl here in a little bit and can contend for the West, be at in the second spot. I don't – a third spot. Because Auburn and Alabama, in my opinion, are going to be
square off for the West in that last game of the year, likely.
Man, Mississippi State's right there, and I think obviously Mississippi State's going to play both of them. So I think Mississippi State Auburn is next week, if I'm not mistaken. Just think about the murderer's row each of these teams is going through. It's crazy what you have to do in the SEC West to have a chance to win a championship. It's
this may be the best game.
If you think about the Big Ten. Every single week of the SEC West would be the best game on their schedule. Every week. Like, every single team they played. Like, you don't get an Indiana. You don't get Northwestern. You don't get any breaks, any Illinois. You've got to play even Arkansas. Ask Texas A&M what they think.
The game everyone thought would be their break game, well, now it's not a break game. Mm-hmm. Now that's Arkansas, who may
is gonna punch you in the
beat
face,
you up, yeah.
And Kevin Sumlin said as much. He said that was brutal. What they did schematically was, and he said they asked him what they thought of Arkansas's offensive line. Did you hear what he said? Five Paul Bunyans. That's so cool. Like, that makes me feel good as a Razorback fan to hear people talk that way about our team. Just we've asked today, how do you think has Arkansas improved every game? I believe they have. I believe it's something like. Just finish. Get there to the end. I made the point on Monday, and I was still a little bitter about the game, that they played a little Houston nuttish, played not to lose at the end. I still believe they did that, but I can see the improvement. I can see the only thing that I want to see improve through the end of this year is I want to see some wide receivers step up that Brandon Allen can trust. I think he made some throws this last week that were, again, and someone said as much too, he made some throws to some covered wide receivers that were really, really good throws. I just don't think that he has the trust in those receivers that, all right, I'm going to throw this and they're going to make a play and they're not going to, it's not going to come back to bite me. Last year, it's every time I throw it, I feel like it's going to be intercepted because somebody's going to do something stupid and it's going to hit the shoulder pad and or they're just going to run the wrong route and I'm going to throw it directly to the safety. All it takes to throw an interception in football in any level is for you're supposed to run the post, you run the out, safety, you throw it right at the safety and the interception. That type of thing is what I think is going on in the back of Brandon Allen's mind because I don't think he trusts these wide receivers. And would you? If you're the quarterback out there and you got Keon Hatcher and Cody Hollister, yeah, I'm just gonna let them go get it. No, you're gonna say that guy's gonna have to be open. And I'm gonna have to see them open rather than throwing them open, which is a huge difference.
Friday, we should dig into recruiting, speaking of wide receivers,
yeah,
and maybe see if we can get Jason to come on and talk about the targets at wide receiver. And also tied in that Arkansas is going to be going after in the next few months. I'd be interested to hear.
It's frustrating for me to see the leading receivers be tight ends. And it was two tight ends this last game, Hunter Henry and A.J. Derby. Both of them played well. I don't understand the reverse to A.J. Derby. That's neither here nor there. But to not see, that just tells me he does not have, Brandon Allen and the offensive coaches don't have any faith in the wide receivers. Keon Hatcher's your best guy. He shouldn't be your best guy. I mean, he should be your worst guy. As far as, you know, and next year they'll have JoJo Robinson, who they're looking to redshirt just because he was an idiot. I'll just say that. He wasn't taking care of his business, and they said, all right, we're not going to play you, and now we're going to redshirt you because it's too late. Five games in, after three games at that point before the fourth game, they're not going to play you now. I know we've ripped some redshirts off some folks. Rip one off Cole Headland, by the way. You need a kicker who can make a 40-yard field goal. That's just SEC football. You've got to have a kicker who can make a 40-yard field goal. Ask Alabama. Lee Tiffin. But wide receiver targets, you don't want to count on K.J. Hill and possibly LaMichael Petway next year as freshman. You would like to see Kendrick Edwards, the 6'6 Miami product who caught the first big pass of the game Saturday. You'd like to see him step up from year one to year two. You'd like to see JoJo Robinson, who was the scout team MVP the week before last, going up against Northern Illinois, or maybe it was Texas Tech. We'd like to see them step in next year. And Drew Morgan, who I think he dislocated his kneecap.
That's right.
You'd like to see him step up. Next year would be his junior year. You'd like to see big-time wide receivers step up and become comfortable targets for Brandon Allen. That's my next progression. I think you're going to see the offensive and defensive lines improve and play well. I like Rory Seagrist and what I'm seeing from him as far as the defensive line and the size that Ben Herbert's putting on some of these guys, the good weight, losing weight, the shifting around, and just making them five Paul Bunyans on the offensive line. Wide receiver is the next frontier. A lot of people say quarterback. I would be much, much happier to see Brandon Allen throw to Jarius Wright and Greg Childs than Cody Hollister and Keon Hatcher.
Well, nobody can really deny how much better Brandon Allen has been this year.
He has been
very complete good. 180.
I do have to give him his credit.
He looks good. Well, but I think it's like you said, people are putting a lot of blame on him when he doesn't feel comfortable throwing to these guys. So we'll probably find out what he's made of next year when hopefully he has some targets that he's comfortable with besides, you know, two or three tight ends.
Seriously, so. Like, oh, I'm most comfortable here because I see A.J. Derby and
Hunter Henry
and Jeremy Sprinkle in the game. Right. I know they're going to catch it. You know, it's like having a bunch of Jason Wittens out there. Just hit them in the numbers. And things are going to be all right. I think things will get better. I hope you're like me and you've taken your time to vent. And by Friday, you'll be ready to talk about Alabama. You'll be able to preview these college football games of the week and then ask how Arkansas can improve going into Alabama, how they can mentally prepare for a game like that. This bye week, like you said, has come at the best time possible for Arkansas. So that's all the time we've got for today. We'll be back on Friday. For Mattie, I'm Mark. Saying so long. 11 o'clock on Friday at rivervalleyleader.com.